Good morning. Hi, everyone. Thank you very much for coming along. So today I'm going to talk about Docker. I call it Docker for .NET developers. You don't need to be a .NET developer to follow along. Most of this is focusing on the Docker side of things, but I do want to show that we can containerize .NET applications. I've got a link there for the slides, so you don't have to go through and take photographs of every slide you see. The slides are online if you want to get to those. And if you want to kind of read a bit more detail about any of the stuff that I cover today, I have done a number of blog posts about Docker on my blog, stevejgordon.co.uk. So if you want to sort of dive in a bit deeper, head along there, and hopefully that will help you out. And if it doesn't, do reach out to me via Twitter. So in terms of what I want to cover today, I want to really talk about a journey that we went on at the company I work for. So I work for a company called Magix, based in the UK, and we do software as a service, job board, and recruiter software, primarily. And about two and a half years ago, we started a new project that sort of led us down this path to learning about Docker and getting started with it. So I want to talk about why we did that, what problems that we were trying to solve. And along the way, I'll introduce you to the basics of what is Docker, how to get started with Docker files, Docker Compose, and then we'll talk about how we're actually running our Docker containers now in production using a service from Amazon called ECS. So let's start with the what is Docker part. If I asked you to put your hands up, how many people have heard of Docker at least? Yeah, so it's almost impossible as a developer not to have heard the term. How many people are actually already using it for something in practice? Yeah, so far fewer. So it's definitely kind of a buzzword, and as people start to talk about sort of microservices or cloud native, containerization is a sort of technology that is growing in popularity. And primarily what Docker allows us to do is to package up an application with all of the dependencies it needs to run, and then use that as a unit of deployment and run that on a workload somewhere in the cloud or on a host machine locally. So there's a few key terms that I like to set early on. So there's this term of an image. And an image really is just a template for a container that you're going to run later on. So you build this image up front to find all of the things that you want to be in that image. And then that can be your unit of deployment that you pass around to your different environments. When you then run one of those images, you run it as a container. And a container is just a sort of sandboxed instance of a particular image. And you can run multiple instances of that same image on the same host, or you can run multiple different containers from different images on that host. And the host is really just any physical or virtual machine somewhere that you're going to run these workloads on. So one of the first comparisons people start to try and make is, what is the difference then between sort of this containerization technology and a technology like virtual machines that we're probably all more familiar with? So on this diagram here, this sort of represents a simplified view of a virtual machine stack. You've got a physical host somewhere, you've got a host OS, and then you've got this hypervisor layer, this Hyper-V VMware, something that's going to allow you to essentially separate the hardware in a virtual way so that you can share it among your different hosts. So you start to abstract that hardware layer with the hypervisor. And then you install your guest operating system into each of your VMs, you install any dependencies you have for your application to run, and then you place your application in there as well. And some cases that may be a single app to a single virtual machine. Something like SQL Server typically gets run on its own, but you may run also multiple applications on a single virtual machine. So typically a web server is going to be hosting multiple websites, for example. And that's sort of the stack that we're used to. If I now show you what the sort of Docker stack looks like, at the bottom we still have a physical host somewhere, of course. We still have a host operating system. But the next layer is this Docker engine, which is a software layer that lets us build, ship, run, and deploy containers. And what this is going to do is essentially abstract the kernel of the host OS so that we can now start to carve that up and apportion it to different sandbox containers that are going to share that same kernel. What this means is, inside the containers themselves, we don't need to install a full guest operating system. We're going to share the kernel of the host machine, and we're just going to layer in a very small file system veneer at the bottom of that container, which contains the file system for the distribution that we want to run on top of the kernel. So typically, I'm sort of mostly talking about Linux containers today. So typically, your host machine might be like an Ubuntu box running on the top of a standard Linux kernel. And inside your containers, you may run Alpine or Debian, for example, just by layering in that file system. Then you layer in your dependencies again, and then you place your application code on top. Now, it's a pretty much a one-to-one relationship with a single application or single process inside each container. And each of these runs in its kind of own little sandbox world. You can allow them to communicate with each other, and you can allow certain communication through from the host, but you have a lot more control over that. Some of the benefits of moving towards this kind of container approach is we end up with a very small unit of deployment. What we're talking about shipping around is not a full guest OS image. We're talking about just that small file system that we need. And so we can ship these containers and these images containers into the cloud. You're talking a few hundred megabytes typically. I mean, some images will be under 100 megabytes. With virtual machines, you're typically talking about having to deploy larger physical sizes, and that may be harder to move around different environments. They're also very lightweight when they're running, because again, they don't need to boot that operating system. They're sitting on top of that shared kernel, which is already running on the host machine. So really, you only need to think about the memory and CPU requirements of your own application. And where this gets useful is we can then pack a lot more workload onto a single machine, but still have that isolation of running things separately so that they don't affect one another. So you can start to get much better utilization of your hardware resource. You also get the benefit that containers start extremely quickly. When you issue a command to launch a container, you could be talking under a second or so for the actual container to start up. Then you need to bootstrap your app in there. But typically, our containers are starting up in a few seconds. And where this is really useful is in terms of scale. If you want to scale in response to a sudden peak of requests coming into your application, or maybe it's a queue processing service and there's a sudden spike in the queue volume, you can scale up incredibly quickly. And it means you don't have to start to over-provision or pre-provision workloads, as you might do with the VM world, to try and accommodate that load in advance of it actually occurring. Containers can be much more reactive. And then finally, there's a nice degree of reliability that we get with Docker in terms that the images themselves are immutable. So you define the steps to build an image. And once that image has been built, it cannot change. And what this means is you know that the dependencies that you layered in there are going to be a particular version. You know that your application code that you've layered in is a particular version. And you know that those two things work together. So what you've built in development will work in any other deployment environment where you deploy it. And that's really useful. With VMs, you can start to get drift between environments. Someone patches one of the production machines, and you find that has unexpected side effects for your application. You don't tend to get that with Docker. So the project we started on, as I say, about two and a half years ago is called Magix Insights. And this was a greenfield project. And it's basically a reporting and analytics tool for our customers over the top of data that they get from their job boards. So our main product is an enterprise job board platform. And so our clients have many millions of events occurring a day in those job boards, people viewing jobs, people posting jobs. And what they wanted to do is have a nice way to build custom reports over the top of that activity and understand really what was happening inside their business. So we started to build this out and greenfield, so we had the choice to do pretty much whatever we wanted technology-wise and in terms of the architecture as well. So we decided we would use microservices. Partly it was because that was a really popular buzzword when we started, so we thought, okay, we have to use microservices. But also, to be a bit more serious, they are suited to what we're doing. We've got lots of small, discrete workloads that we want to have. We've got certain processing services. We've got data extraction processes. And then we've got APIs that need to serve various parts of this front-end system. And we could see that there was a single responsibility to a lot of these that meant if we put them in a microservice, we could discreetly scale those, and we can deploy them independently when we need to make changes. We also made the decision we'd use .NET Core and ASP.NET Core. It was very new at the time, but we could kind of see the future of that product. We wanted to take advantage of the improved performance there, and primarily we were looking at potentially running at the time on Linux VMs, so we wanted the cross-platform functionality of .NET Core there. And then finally, we decided that we would use a single-page app as our front-end for this system. So our front-end team is kind of separate to the guys like me on the back-end, and they wanted to use Vue.js and just cool APIs that we would expose for them. So to sort of break apart part of that architecture, this is just the front-end system, really, of the application. And this is the sort of bit that I'm going to sort of demo bits of today. And so at the front, we've got a single-page app. And then we have three different front-end services that it can talk to. And each of these is its own API. And we split these up on the basis that they are essentially different domains. So they don't need to know about one another all of the time. We could separate them, we could give them their own database, and we can then scale each of these independently. Typically, that report API is the API that gets called the most, and it's the one that's doing the most work to actually generate reports for people. So we probably need to scale that more often than we would a user API, which is just handling occasional logins. So we split those up that way. And then we also decided to build this backend API that we would use not only for the report API here, but for internal services. And what this does is it takes what the user sort of deals with, which in their domain is things like what a report looks like in terms of what dimensions and metrics they want to have in their report, how they're going to sort it and filter it. We kind of deal with that in the front end. But by the time it reaches the back end of the query API, we need to convert that kind of definition into various Elasticsearch queries. So we're running on top of a very large Elasticsearch cluster here. I think we've got about 10 billion documents in there at the moment. And that's what we're using to store all of the events that are coming in from our various systems. And so that query API is that sort of translation layer. So it's its own separate service. So one of the things that we could see as we were sketching this out was that we needed to start to deal with the challenge of how we were going to deal with the developer workflow, not just for back-end developers, but also for front-end teams that would need all of these services running in order to actually test their front-end out thoroughly. And so how were we going to give them a reasonable story? And to give you a bit of background, the sort of direction that we were coming from is this is sort of the rough workflow for a front-end developer on our existing legacy monolith. So this is our sort of job board platform software that we've had for about 17 years. And it's quite a complex process for them to actually work on it. They need to pull down the full platform code onto their machine to be able to spin it up. And that platform is, it's many, I think we're over 100 projects in there. It's a very big solution. It takes time to pull and it takes time to build. They also need to pull down individual client projects, which are then specific to each client that runs because we can do certain customizations for each client. And the next thing they need to do is actually build this on their machine. But they're typically running on a Mac, so they end up with a virtual machine running Windows. And inside there, they've got Visual Studio and MS Build, and then they can build it. Then they've got this huge script of various registry settings that they need to have set up and configuration that needs to be configured in IIS for this to actually run properly on their machine. So there's a whole process they have to go through. And we've got it reasonably efficient, but it's still an area of pain for the team, particularly if they're switching client projects regularly. So we wanted to try and deal with that, and then we wanted to work out how we didn't make things even worse by going microservices. So this is the kind of picture of where we're at today. And there are steps along the way that I haven't got time to kind of cover here. So this is kind of the end picture that we've kind of evolved into. And what we're doing today is we're actually using our CI/CD system to build images for every check-in that we do. And these are Docker images. So we have a script that builds the Docker images and pushes it up to what's called a container registry. And this is just a store for Docker images. A bit like you use NuGet for packages, you use a container registry to store your Docker images and then pull them down in a different environment when you need them. So we build our code, push it up to the registry, and then the front-end developers are given this file called a Docker Compose file, and we'll look at an example of one shortly. But this file basically specifies one or more services that you want to run together as a kind of whole system. And in that file, we specify all of the APIs that need to start up, and also things like a Postgres database, and even, if they need be, an Elasticsearch cluster. We can specify all that in one file, and all they need to do is run two commands. A Docker Compose pull command pulls all of the latest images down onto their machine. It doesn't take too long, they're pretty small. And then the Docker Compose up command spins up that entire environment in containers on their machine, and they're able to begin working in a matter of only a few seconds sometimes. And all they need to run this is just to have Docker running on their machine. So we have got rid of all these dependencies because now we actually put the dependencies and the configuration into the images for them. And we know because they're immutable, no one's going to tinker with those and mess with them. So they're always going to run in the same way that we expect them to. And when we presented this to the team, the feedback was, this is amazing. They were really positive about the steps we'd taken. And this was when we were very new to Docker, and we hadn't learned all the tricks yet. But even just getting this working with a few APIs, with a single command, they could really see the power of this in terms of the consistency and the ease of their workflows. So what I want to do now is try my first demo, which is always good fun. This is quite a simple one, and what I want to do is just show you how we can get started with a really basic containerization of an ASP.NET Core application. So I've got a really standard empty, essentially, template here. So this is using the API template you get for ASP.NET Core. This is 2.1 at the moment. I've just upgraded it. So there's nothing in here that's custom or particularly complex, but it gives you an idea of the application. The only thing I have done in this file is add this single file, which is in the root of my solution called the Docker file. And we'll have a look at that in a moment. That's not there by default. You need to add that. If you do want to use the tooling for this, zoom out so I can see what I'm doing, you can actually now in Visual Studio just use this add Docker support option here. And that will, Microsoft will sort of basically do the work for you of adding in a Docker file, adding in things like Docker compose files and various scripts to even allow you to debug into running containers from Visual Studio. This kind of technology wasn't available when we started 2.5 years ago. Microsoft haven't got that far along yet. So we ended up doing things manually, but I still think there's value in showing that, because if you understand how to do these things manually, it's a lot easier when the tooling does it wrong to fix it. So in this case, this is the controller that we've got in this application. It's just returning a basic array of values, nothing exciting. The Docker file that I've added looks like this. So we've got six commands in this file, and I'll just sort of briefly go through what each of those is doing so you can understand. But this is all I need to do to build an image that will run this later on. So this first command is the from command, and the from command is how we specify a base image. So typically, when you're building Docker images, you don't want to have to control all of the dependencies, all of the layers of things that you might need. You typically base your image on something that already exists, but just layer in some additional stuff. So you can't change the existing image, but you can use it as a starting point. And basically, Docker is a series of image layers, and you just build these layers up with all of the dependencies you need until you have everything that your application needs to run. Now, in this case, I'm using an image from Microsoft called the .NET image. And this is their image that allows you to either build or run .NET Core applications. And the colon here, so at the end of this, we've got this colon 2.1 SDK. That's a tag. This identifies essentially a version of this image. And in this case, what we're saying is I want the 2.1 image that includes the .NET Core SDK, because I'm going to actually use this image to actually build my source code, so I need the full SDK. Before you sort of take a photo of this and run away to work and start deploying it, this isn't a production-ready image. Don't just copy this. I will show you towards the end a bit more of a production-ready image, because this one gets pretty large. Because the SDK is quite big and we're actually copying in our full source code, we haven't really optimized this for size. So we're talking around 600-700 megabytes for this kind of image. The next command here is the working directory commands, and this just specifies when we're inside this image and we're layering things into it, what directory are we working in? So by convention, more than anything else, we use this slash app folder inside the image. The next command is a copy command. And what we're doing with the copy command is basically saying we need to take files off of my laptop here and place them inside the image that we want to build. So take files from the host and put it into the image. So there's two parts to the command. There's the source, which is basically relative to the context that I'm building this Docker image in on my machine. So this is basically I'm saying I want to take my source folder and this project folder called demo1, and I want to copy everything that's in there, so all of the source code for that API, into the image. And where I want to put it into the image is relative to the where we set as the working directory. So in this case, I'm saying, well, just copy it right into that slash app folder that we said will be our working directory for this image that we're building. So at this point, we've got the source code copied in. Now we can run any number of commands in here to configure this image and set it up how we want to. In my case, what I'm going to do is actually just build my source code inside the image. So it's perfectly possible to build your source first and then copy in your built assemblies. But in this case, I'm actually using an SDK image, which is I know has got a consistent SDK version, and I'm using that to run the .NET command. So .NET build is just going to build my source code inside this image that we're creating. The next command is more of a documentation command than a physical activity. It just says that when this runs, we're going to expect this container to need to expose port 80, because this is a web app. So internally, the container is going to be running the Kestrel web server. That will be listening on port 80. And that just identifies that if we want to be able to communicate with this container, we're going to need to allow that port through from the host. And then finally, we have the entry point command. And all this is saying to Docker is, when you start a container from this image, this is the process I want you to start. So in this case, we're just issuing the .NET run command. And because our code's built inside there, it'll just run the application from that built assembly that we've got inside the image. And at this point, we will have a Docker image ready to go. So I've got this Docker file. I'm going to actually now use that Docker file. So I'm just in the directory where the Docker file exists. This is basically the root of my solution here. And then I'm going to issue a Docker build command. So this will say that we're going to build an image. One of the things we're going to need to do is identify this. So I need to tag this with an image name. Let's call this demo one. And then finally, I need to tell it where is the build context. So where is it expecting to find the files, and basically where is its starting point as we do this build? So in this case, I'm going to say, well, I'm actually in the directory. I'm in the directory with the Docker file and all of the code that we want to work against. So I can just pass the dot there. And I run that, and it ran really quickly. And it's a bit of a cheat. I've obviously tested this demo works. And one of the nice things about Docker is if nothing changes between builds, it will actually cache each step as a kind of temporary layer. And so you can see here we've got steps 1 to 6 have been run. And in each time, it's actually just used the cache in this example. So for real, this takes maybe 30 seconds or so, because it's got to actually get the application copied in and then do the actual build command. But if it doesn't need to, it won't try and redo that work. And that's quite, we can take advantage of that later on our build server. So I've now created this image. And I'm going to do a Docker run command. What we need to do, because this is going to be expecting to listen on port 80 internally, that's not going to be automatically something we can use from the host machine. But we do want to actually communicate with this container. So I need to do what's called a publishing a port. So I need to say, actually, what I want to do is put 6001 on my laptop and pipe that through to port 80 on this container. So containers are kind of locked down by default. And now that I've done that, I can just give the name of the image that I want to run on my machine and hit enter. So what that's going to do is it's going to start the container. As I say, that takes a second or so. And now you can see that Kestrel is already launched inside that container. And in this case, I'm just allowing the output to spit out to my console. And you can see there that Kestrel is now listening on port 80. This is inside that container. If I jump over to browser and hit that URL, we should expect to see those values. Nothing, you know, I could have made that more exciting, I guess. But the idea is that we're running this now as a container. We built it sort of very quickly with those 6 commands as an image, ran the container, and now we're actually running that container on our machine. And we can pass that image to anyone else that's Docker on their machine, and they can start the same image, and they'll have the same results on their machine. So just briefly, because I've sort of talked about this concept of image layering, this isn't like super important to sort of take away and learn, but a bit like Julie said before, let this wash over you and just have it in the back of your mind if you need it. What this image layering allows us to do is to base our image on something that already has what we need. And to give you an idea of what happened when we did that with the ASP.NET Core one, is we have this layer that starts right at the very bottom of any image stack. And this is a scratch image from Docker. At this point, we've just basically got an empty image starting point. There's nothing in here at all. Then there'd be a layer that brings in the file system. And in the case of the .NET SDK, they've sort of chosen a layering stack that is based on top of Debian. So there's a Debian image here that's about 45 megs in size. So that's just the file system to run Debian on top of that shared OS kernel. There's a couple of layers that bring in, essentially, these are dependencies of the ASP.NET Core and .NET Core SDK, because they need to be able to get that SDK from somewhere. So these layers bring in things like curl, wget, git, mercurial, a few bits and pieces that might be needed when you're using builds inside this image. And so that's how the ASP.NET team actually bring in the SDK when they're installing their layer. And that's the next layer. So that was the .NET layer, the .NET with the :2.1 SDK. And that was what we had as our from command. So by specifying that as our from command, we got that layer, but we got all of the dependencies below there as well as part of that image that we were starting from. And then finally, we layered in our code on top of that. So we've built this layered stack that allows us to run this consistently, knowing that all of these dependencies will remain the same inside this immutable image. So we've seen how we can do like a really simple single application inside a container. The problem we were trying to solve was this problem of multiple applications, and we wanted the front-end team to spin them up at the same time. And so where we ended up was a tool called Docker Compose that I'm going to show you now. And what Docker Compose does is allow you to basically specify a set of services you want to start up together. So in this example, I've made this hugely more complicated, and I've added a second API. So it's now 2 template APIs. But there's a backend API that I consider sort of internal. So I wouldn't expose this out publicly. And this is going to be like sort of similar to what we've done with our query API. It's kind of an internal API. The front-end service represents our report API. So this is the service that's exposed on the web that the front-end system's calling. And basically, for this to function, I need both APIs started on the machine together. So the backend controller, so for the backend API, just similar to what we did before, it's just going to return a couple of strings, nothing exciting there. The front-end controller is not that much more complex, but what we're doing with this one is basically using HTTP client to make a call to that back-end service. And the way we know where that URL is for that back-end service is going to come from ASP.NET Core configuration. So this is something you get with ASP.NET Core really easily. It's a really nice configuration system. And we can just apply that here to set up whatever the back-end URL will be when we run this application. So this front-end service is just making a request to the back-end, getting the data, and in this case, just returning it straight on. Each of those has its own Docker file because we want to create our own Docker image for it. So we've got two Docker files, and basically they're identical in this case, and they're just going to create simple images for each of those APIs. And then we've got this Docker compose file. So this is the file that sort of essentially does the useful stuff. And this is what we give our front-end developers. In our case, we have like, I think, 7 or 8 services specified in here that should start up. In this case, we've just got the two. So we've specified a service for our back-end service. And then what we provide is a build context. So this is where is the Docker file, where are the actual source files for that are going to be used to build an image for that service. It is possible inside a Docker Compose to actually point it to a pre-existing image, which you typically do, and we're doing in our actual solution now, is actually we're building our images in our sort of build system and storing them up in a container registry. So the Docker Compose we give our front-end developers just points them to those existing images. But you can also do what we're doing here, which is actually get Docker Compose to build the images for you. I can give this a name. That's not too important, but it's useful when it's running to be able to refer to the container. The front-end service then, again, has a build context. We've then got this ports command. And this is very similar to what we did in the original Docker run command, is publishing a port. So we need to say that this front-end service needs to be exposed on 5001 on the host. We haven't done that on the back-end, because I never expect anyone to communicate directly with the back-end system, only this front-end service. And by default, when you start services inside a Docker Compose file, they end up on a Docker network. So they can communicate with each other inside that Docker network, inside that sort of safety boundary. So I don't actually need to publish any ports in the back-end service. I then set an environment variable. And this is typically how you're going to get configuration into containers. When you start them up, you want to pass in certain config. And in this case, what we're doing is passing in the config that sets the back-end URL. So I need to pass the URL to that back-end service. And because these are on that Docker network, I can actually just use the same service name that I specified above for the back-end service. And the Docker network and the DNS that it uses will actually resolve that for us. And then finally, we've got this depends on command that makes sure that the containers start in roughly the right order, because there's no point in the front-end service being ready before the back-end. So now if I jump over to a command prompt, this is where the Docker compose file is on my machine. And I'm just going to do Docker compose up on this one. And this is the command that we give our front-end developers to run. And it will inspect the file. It will work out what services are needed. Starts a container for each of them in this case. And those have now started. And it's just now attaching the output onto my console. And you can see we've now got the two services listening in on port 80. So there's two Kestrel web servers in individual containers running on my machine now. And if I jump over and change this now to the 5001 port, you should see the values. So we've spoken to the front-end API. That's made a back-end call over that Docker network to the back-end service, and now we've got the values. And this is essentially what we're doing, just in a more complicated way for our front-end developers. But it's very quick and easy for them to spin up what they need to. So at this point, we'd kind of solved our initial problem of how we were going to get our front-end developer workflow to be reasonably straightforward. The next thing we started to think about was actually, could we take containers all the way to production? Because originally, the idea was just to kind of develop using them and then have some other way of deploying. But when we realized that containers actually were quite a nice way to do these deployments and to package our applications up, we sort of looked at the options. So the flow that we've actually ended up with at a very high level looks a bit like this. So all of our individual APIs or services are their own Git repository. So I make some changes on one of those repositories, check in the code, and push it up to our internal Bitbucket server. We have a Jenkins build system that's monitoring all of those repos. As soon as it detects the change, it will pull that down and then follow a build script. And we keep those build scripts actually inside the repos as well. And I'll show you an example of one shortly. What that basically does is build an image inside using the same sort of commands that we've used before. And once we've got that image, pushes it up to that container registry I was talking about. So that's running up on AWS. Then we issue a command to the AWS service called ECS, Elastic Container Service. And this is an orchestrator that I'll explain more in a moment. But basically, that's going to kick off instances of these containers in production. And now we've got our code running. And what we've actually ended up with here is a continuous delivery, zero downtime deployment. So I check code in and push it. It's going to be live in about 5 minutes for that service. There's no gates. There's no points where we check this. We do run unit tests at the build stage, but otherwise it's going straight out. And this has made us really agile. We've been able to do, you know, 10, 15, 20 deployments in a day. We can do small iterative changes, so we've got less risk with each deployment we do. And if we do introduce any issues, we can get fixes out very quickly. So I mentioned sort of orchestration. And the reason we want orchestration in production is you don't want to be manually typing Docker commands to run these containers in the real world. What happens if one of the containers dies? Are you going to be monitoring that and running commands? And even with Docker Compose, it makes it easy to spin up multiple things. It's not maintaining what's happening within those containers. It starts them up, and it's essentially fire and forget. So orchestrators allow the easy management of production workloads with multiple containers. They deal with things like how you get those deployed, sometimes with rollback support. Scaling is a really important scenario. So how are those going to be scaled out? Health monitoring. So if one of the containers dies, it's going to make sure a new instance is started up. Service discovery, because when we're running these across usually VM hosts in the cloud, you don't really know where they're going to start up, which machine. It's up to the orchestrator where they start. So it needs to maintain an understanding of where each service is, what IP addresses and ports can connect to those. There's load balancing. If you're running an API as we are, you're going to have multiple instances of the API. So how do we get the traffic to balance across those? And doing things like configuration management and making sure that the containers start with the right configuration. So an orchestrator does all of this. We're using, as I say, Amazon's ECS. So this is their Elastic Container Service, which is a managed sort of orchestrator. So we don't have to manage or own the actual kind of hosts that maintain the cluster management. That's all kind of done by Amazon. What we provide it is the host that we want to run containers on, and then the configuration for the workload we expect it to run. And after that, it does all of the management. Now, when we started, this was our best option for a managed service in AWS. Today, I would probably recommend you look at Kubernetes. I'm sure it's a term that many of you have heard. Kubernetes has kind of pretty much won the battle of orchestrators and is a very popular choice. And now all of the cloud providers have their own managed Kubernetes environments. So if you want something that's very well documented, very well understood, and can run on any cloud, Kubernetes is probably your choice. But for us, ECS is working perfectly well, and we are sort of all our services are in AWS. So for us, it hasn't made any real sort of business case for us to actually move over to Kubernetes yet. There's a few key components. I'll run through them briefly. Again, don't feel that you need to kind of take this all in. Just have an idea of what some of these bits mean. So there's a cluster at the heart of everything. You create a cluster, which is just a logical grouping for EC2 instances. So these are the hosts, basically, that you can run containers on. There's nothing particularly special about these. They can be any different instance sizes that you want. You can split them into different regions if you want to, so you can get some sort of safety nets there that if one region goes down, you've still got instances running somewhere. And the only special thing about these is that they are basically running from an image from Amazon that includes this ECS agent, and that's what allows ECS to start and stop containers on these machines. Underneath that, we need to specify what we want to run, and we define that as a service in AWS, and a service uses a task definition file that is quite similar to the Docker Compose we looked at before. It really just specifies one or more containers to run. ECS does allow you to run multiple containers under the guise of a service, but typically I recommend that you just have one container to one service, because these are your unit of deployment and scale. If you want to scale these out, you scale the service. So if you put all of your containers together as one service, you can only scale the whole system together. So each of our APIs, each of our sort of processing services has a service that defines how it runs. And then you specify how many of that thing you want to run and maybe some guidance for where they can start. And ultimately, what it will do, it will start tasks. And these are essentially your containers that are now going to be running on your host machines. And it will spread them across the host. It's kind of random. You can give it some control about where it goes. But ultimately, we don't care. We just want containers running somewhere. We just want instances of our services. On top of this, because this is a web-facing system in most cases, a lot of ours are APIs and they need to be on the web, we need to load balance across these. And Amazon have a service called their Application Load Balancer that we're using. It integrates really nicely with ECS. So ECS can notify of things it's deploying. And the important thing is, which IP address has that started on? Which host is it on? Which port has it been given? Because you don't want to fix each service to a particular port, because then you can only run one in each instance on each host. So the ports are essentially random, and ECS knows where they are, and it can tell the load balancer. So in a scenario where something goes wrong, one of our tasks blows up and we lose that, the next thing that happens is the load balancer detects this because it's health checking all of the sort of web-facing instances it knows about. And if any of them stop responding, it immediately takes them out of its target group, which should work. Yeah. So it's no longer going to send traffic there. The service is also monitoring all of the tasks that it started up. And if any of them do fail, its job is to start a new instance of those. My clicker's died. Let's just rerun that. So the service's task is to, his job is to start that new instance of the task running on the host. It's not necessarily going to be the same instance, and that's important. You don't care, again, where these are running. In this case, it has chosen the same instance. It's told the load balancer this now has run back up again, and now it's available to use. So I'm going to show you just briefly what this looks like, so a simplified version of our actual production workflow. So I'm going to hop over to my final solution. But before I show you that, actually, let's show you the running app. So I've got a really complex app. And this is running in AWS. It's a production URL. I'm just using the load balancer URL for now, because I don't need a fancy URL for this sample. And I'm just returning a string in this case, nothing particularly exciting. But let's imagine I want to change that value. So I'm going to come over to my controller here. I'm just going to change this to a Prague. Let's commit this change. As all good developers, I'll use a really descriptive commit message. And I'm going to push this up to, in my case, I'm just using GitHub for this example. In our real system, it's our internal Bitbucket. But I'll just make sure this pushes up. Conference Wi-Fi is hopefully working. And now I'm going to trigger a build. So this is a Jenkins box. I'm actually running this as a container on my machine because I didn't want to install Jenkins on this machine. So this is actually running as a container currently. And I'm going to trigger this build. And as soon as that fires off, we'll dive in and just check that it's running. So in our real system, this would happen automatically. And you can see it started to run some steps. So in order to catch that, I'm actually going to jump over now. And so this is the ECS management portal inside Amazon. Like a lot of their services, it takes a bit of getting used to. But ultimately, what I'm looking at here is my cluster. And I've got my service down here. This is the service that's running that API that's returning the string. And as that build happens, one of the steps it's going to do is build the image, and then it's going to push that image to AWS. But then it's also going to notify this service that I now want to trigger launching a new instance of that new deployed application. So I'm going to sort of refresh this in the hope that we can kind of catch it happening. It's kind of 50-50 as to whether we'll see it. But what I'm looking at here is currently my service, I've said I've got a desired count of one. I've got one instance that I want running of this. And there it is. So after a period of time, it's now triggered this new image. And you can actually see that we're running two. So I said I wanted one. I've got two. And that's because it's zero downtime. So it's going to start up a new container running the new image that we've just built and deployed. And it's going to make sure that that's healthy and responding properly before it starts to take down the old container. And so this is all going to happen with the load balancer behind the scenes. And if I jump into the events for this service, we can actually see some of the detail about what's actually happening here. So you can see that we've started a new task a few minutes ago. That's that new task running that new image. It's registered it now with the target group, so it's now with the load balancer. And so what the load balancer is going to be doing is now pinging the health check endpoint of this service to make sure that it's actually started up and is responding. So if I refresh this a couple of times, we'll see if we can catch it. There it is. So now that new service is responding as healthy. What we've got here is the existing service now is starting to be drained out of the load balancer. So any existing connections are being allowed to finish, but it's not going to start sending new traffic over to that URL. So I'm hoping if I come over here and refresh this now, we've got the updated title. Not a massive big finish, but you get the idea. We've done this without taking the application down. And it's been a really quite quick process to get that out into production. And if I look at my solution briefly, I'll just show you what's involved. So we've obviously got that controller that's returning that value. I've got a Docker file here. It's a bit more complex than what I showed you at the start. So don't panic and don't, again, feel that you need to understand all of this immediately. Just be aware of what you can do with a Docker file. So for us, in the first example, I said it wasn't a production-ready image. And the reason it's not a production-ready image is it's a big image. We've got the whole SDK in there that we don't really need when we're actually running in production. So what we're doing here is I'm using a multi-stage Docker image file. So it's going to basically build an initial image that builds an SDK image where we put our source code, and then it builds that source code. That will then basically publish the built assemblies into a folder. And then we're going to start a second image step that's actually going to take those built assemblies and bring them into a runtime-only image. And that's going to be the image that we want to deploy because it's more lightweight. So the key difference is here in our from command, we've got this as published. So this now we're starting to use multiple stages. We need to identify them. So this says this is the publish stage. I use a publish working directory. And then I copy my solution file and, in this case, two project files, my actual application and my unit test project. Then I do a .NET restore. The reason I do this in this order is for the caching advantages of the build system. So I said earlier that the layers will be cached if nothing changes. At this point, it's very rare that the CSproj files change, only if we update the NuGet packages or add a new dependency. So typically, the copy stages and even the .NET restore can be cached on the build server. And this means our builds are generally pretty quick because we haven't got to wait for a full restore each time. So once we've got that stage, we then copy our test folder and our source folder. These typically will change. So from this point onwards, it's typically not going to be using cached values. We do a .NET build as we did before in the release configuration. I then run my unit tests. So this is where we run our unit tests. And at this stage, the test will run inside the image as it's building it. And if any of those tests fail, the image build will fail. And as a result, our Jenkins build will fail as well. And that's kind of how we manage it. And we just notify a Slack channel in that situation. There's various different ways people choose to do testing. And at this stage, we could even get more advanced and do even integration testing and spin up instances of these containers and check that they actually can communicate if we wanted to. Then I'm doing a publish. So this is where I'm actually going to publish the built DLLs into a folder. And in this case, I'm choosing to pass them out to this out folder. This will be under the publish working directory that we've created. And then I start the second image stage. So this is the second stage that's now using the runtime image. So this is using a different tag that says we want the 2.1 ASP.NET Core runtime. So that will make sure we've got all the things we need there. The order in this next section differs from what we did before. And this, again, is caching. These commands never change because this is fixed inside the build file. So I can do these up front. And typically, that means that these will always be cached. The only difference would ever happen is if I changed my from command here and used a different base image, then that would have to rebuild. So the final step on this is that we're then going to copy from the publish stage, so from that first image stage that we've been doing, I'm going to copy from its publish out folder, so this is just built assemblies, built DLLs now, and I'm going to copy it into my app folder. And so this is my final image that I'm going to send, and this one I think is around 70 meg. So the SDK image was like 600, 700. This one built on top of Alpine is only about 70 meg. And that makes it much more efficient for me to be shipping this up to AWS every time we do a build. So that's what the doc file looks like. In terms of the actual build script that, as I say, lives inside our repo, this controls what Jenkins is doing. So it's just mostly issuing Docker commands. It's doing a Docker build as we did manually. The name for this is a bit longer because I'm going to push this to a registry. So I need to prefix it with the registry URL where it's going to go. And also, in terms of tagging this, I want to essentially version each image we build. And what we do is just use the Git char. To identify each image. So this means each image we build, we can identify exactly what commit it was built from, which is really useful if we ever have any weird issues once something gets deployed. The next commands just log me into AWS, because to be able to push to the registry, you have to log in a certain way. Then I do a Docker push command to push my image to the registry, a Docker remove command to clean up my build server. So I get rid of the image at this stage. We've published it to a registry, and it's no longer needed on the build server. I do this is just a transform step, so I'll show you the task definition file next, but in there, it needs to refer to the actual image using the image name and the tag, so I have to pass that git commit ID in so it's pointed at the right git tag on our image. And then once I've built the registry, the task definition file, I register up into AWS and say, here's a new task definition I'm going to want you to run, and then I tell the service in ECS, I want you to start up a new instance running this new version, so deploy this out, essentially. And then inside the task definition, it's quite similar to a Docker compose, and I won't go through all the points. But the key bit is here, where it tells it what image to refer to. So this is the full image name with the registry where it exists. Here's that git char that gets replaced by that sort of transform step in our build script. And then the only other thing I want to show is this port mapping. So this is basically similar to the dash p or the ports command in Docker compose. And this says that the container port will be port 80. but assign zero for host. So this is basically dynamic. So this is how we allow multiple instances of the same service to run on the same box. ECS knows what port it uses, and it can tell the load balancer. And basically, that's all we need to get this running in production. So as we sort of draw to the end, I just sort of wanted to summarize some of the things that we've learned along the way with this journey so far. So there is a learning curve to Docker, but in our view, it was really shallow to get started. I think we spent like a day or maybe 2 days just playing around with some of the documentation on the Docker website, and we had that first example that I showed you running in no time at all. And we'd built an image and we'd run it as a container, and we'd seen how easy it was to get started. So that learning curve, you don't have to know everything to begin with. You don't have to know how to build that production-ready image until you're at that point. So start with those small steps, start in development and get the advantages there where typically you're not so concerned about the image size, and then enhance it and improve the build order and things like that as you go. If you don't have stuff you want to containerize of your own, do look at Docker as a great tool for just running dependencies that you have. So if you want to run Postgres for some testing that you're doing, you can spin it up as a container. You don't need to install Postgres on your machine. You start a container using their image. When you're done, you get rid of the container and it's gone off your machine. We use the same for doing, I run a small Elasticsearch cluster in containers on my machine if I want to test a new version of Elasticsearch. It's really convenient for that. And there's this whole Docker hub, which has lots of public images that you can just come pull down onto your machine and start using. Amazon ECS, it is a little complex. I tried to kind of summarize the key points, the key terms, but it just takes a little getting used to. I think that's the case with any orchestrator, though. You have to just use their terminology for how you carve things up. We use CloudFormation in AWS, so if you are going to go for something like ECS, CloudFormation is great because you can specify configuration as code, all of the stuff you need to have spun up. So our systems team have a large CloudFormation file that sets up the cluster, all of the services, all of the hosts that are going to run, the load balancer configuration, and all of those kind of things get set up just in one file, and we can redeploy that environment if we need to. Be aware with ECS of the vendor lock issue. So ECS is a bespoke Amazon orchestrator. You can't just use that somewhere else if you decide to change cloud providers. So that may or may not be a concern. If you are more concerned with that, Kubernetes is a far better option because you can run that yourself on-prem, you can run it on their managed services and in any of the clouds, and you can just really probably take your configuration between most of those. Think about things like logging. As soon as you start going for containers, you need to work out how you're going to get logging out of them. We started off by logging just to the console and using Amazon service where they just take the console logs from all the containers and push them up to their CloudWatch service. We found that quite painful, quite hard to search. So in the end, what we now do is we use Serialog for our logging, and we log out to Elasticsearch, and that's made our lives a lot easier. We can search across all of our logs using things like Kibana. So if you've heard of the Elk stack, it's a really powerful way to manage your logging. And we use correlation IDs, across all of our services. So as things flow through the system, they have a unique ID, and it allows us to tie all of those services together. And then think about your placement of containers. One thing I didn't show you there is, if you don't tell ECS what to do, it will start a container wherever there's even the smallest amount of memory and CPU available, because it doesn't know what your app needs. And if you don't specify, you could start it on a system with maybe only 20 megabytes of memory remaining. So test each of your APIs, get a benchmark for what you need, and you can specify that in your task definition file so that it gives AWS the opportunity to intelligently schedule those things on systems that have at least enough resource. And then finally, the benefits that we've realized with this is that improved developer productivity shouldn't be underestimated. It's been really powerful, and it's allowed us to prototype things very quickly at times. We're starting to build out some new systems now, and it's our go-to tool for just getting some APIs spun up really quickly. You get rid of that "it runs on my machine" argument with front-end developers saying, well, it's not working, because everything's built inside the image. We've built the image and tested it, and it's immutable, so it's going to run. There's no missed configuration settings, no missed registry entries that are going to cause problems. So it's given us really dependable deployments. We can deploy these into production with a guarantee that they're just going to run how we tested them in our local environments. So we've ended up with quite a simple build and deploy process, I think. The things I showed you, although slightly slimmed down, is pretty much what we're doing in production today. So those build scripts aren't much more complicated, and we're just running these services quite happily. We're experimenting with different ways of doing that. We're now using CloudFormation templates as our control rather than pushing up task definitions, and we're actually using that to build up the whole service stack each time, and that's working quite well too. But ultimately, we achieved zero downtime, and we didn't even set out to do that. We weren't really thinking about how we were actually going to keep this service up during deployment. And we assumed we probably would have like deployment windows for certain parts of it. But most of the time, we can just commit code, push it during the middle of the day, and it goes out. And it'll only go out if it works. And ultimately, we've lowered our costs because we're now packing a lot more workload onto just a couple of VMs at times. We're running a really big system that processes 8 million events a day and does lots of data crunching. But sometimes we're only running two medium-sized Amazon VMs under that. If we were running this on individual VMs and trying to keep these services separate, it would have been a lot more cost, we think. So that's it. I've run to 10 seconds left, so there's no time for questions, but I'll hang around. I'm here for the next couple of days, so do come and find me. The slides are on that link there, and do tweet out at me if you have any questions after the event. Thank you very much.